Good morning, everyone. Today, I'm with my co-founder, Minh Tran, and we are going to talk about the world of VCs. So, hi, Minh. Thank you very much for giving me your time today.
Hello, Sabine. Very good to be here.
And I think it's important to say that we know each other for a long time, at least 3 to 4 years, before we decided to work together, isn't it?
Yes. I came across your path when I was at AXA and probably almost 10 years now. So good to go together finally.
Yes. So tell us, Minh, a little bit more about you. I would love for you to share with our listener a little bit more about who you are, what you love, and what you do every day.
So I'm 52 and I've been in corporate venture for 30 years in three different waves. First wave, I was just working for a corporate that wanted to do joint venture. Second wave, I worked for media corporate venture in Bertelsmann when it was doing Audible and Napster. And also for Nokia Venture when they invested in PayPal. That's my second wave. And the third wave, about 10 years ago, I decided to focus on financial services. I work for a VC firm called Truffle Capital. And then I started to launch my own firm on the concept of VC as a service or CVC as a service. And I created back in 2012, AXA Venture or AXA Seed Factory. That was the first insurtech fund in France or in Europe 10 years ago.
Congratulations. You have been very early on the path of corporate venturing. So tell us a little bit more about Mandalore Partners. So we work together at Alchemy Crew, where you support me with my ventures and enabling our corporates to better understand how to excel with growth ventures. But how does Mandalore Partners fit in the equation?
So the name came from a planet of Star Wars because I wanted to look forward more in the future of our things. And I found out that it was a good name to have because there was a lot of stuff about modernity, globality, tech, and of course you may know the Mandalorian, which is Star Wars series, and so I thought it was a good name to have. Most of the corporates we work with are looking into those themes. How can I innovate in the future, not internally but externally? That's the reason why we came into the creation of Mandalore Partners.
And one of your key themes, Minh, is about de-risking innovation with strategic investment. Can you give us a little bit more insight around what that means?
So when you are a corporate venture, you have today two models, right? One is to invest in VC outside, which most, and that's not really corporate venture, but you have that option. And the second option is to create your own team internally. For many reasons, the model of creating an internal team in corporate venture doesn't work in the long run. In the history of corporate venture, it doesn't work after a while, and we can go deeper in that kind of subject. But I started to, from my experience in corporate venture, I started to come with a third model, which is how to actually externalize corporate venture for sourcing, for capacity to reach out to startups with both a financial interest, but also a corporate alignment or a strategic alignment with corporates.
So let's go deeper with this model, which you call VC as a service, to explain to our viewers and listeners what this means. And also, it would be great if you could help us understand why externalizing corporate venturing is important.
So if you go deeper to the model of corporate ventures, there's basically if you want to have an overview of different models, you have four models in this world in a 2x2 matrix. The first axis is if you have a single corporate or you have a multi-corporate, you know, one or many. And the second axis of is you have an internal team or an external team. So let's take, for example, Total Venture from the oil and gas industry. They have one LP and they have an internal team. So the team focus on corporate strategy and alignment and so on. So that's the model where I think it doesn't work in the long run. You have the second model to have one LP, but an external team. You have, for example, Nokia Venture, it's one LP. The team is actually external, structured as an LP. I think AXA as well is one LP, and the team is in the management company. And you have multiple LP in internal team, which does not exist or doesn't work because it's hard to work with different. But they have a few people. But the model that I'm trying to have is the external team. With multiple LP, and that's why we want to reach out. And in this world, you have Touchdown Venture, who's doing that, Redstone as well in Berlin. And this model seems to be a new model when you want to externalize a corporate venture. And you want to do that, why? Because when you are a corporate venture, it's very easy or difficult to attract deals. So it's easy to attract deals because they are linked to your corporate, but it's difficult to make deals because sometimes the best growth venture in the world will go to top tier VCs like Sequoia and so on, or second tier. And then the third tier usually are corporate venture. They think it's, they don't care about financial returns, which is not true, but they have this perception and they think that they just do for corporate reasons and strategic reasons. But so there's a somehow bad reputation of having a corporate venture with the same name as your corporate. And today, a lot of corporate venture are thinking there are maybe a better way to attract best startups by externalizing, maybe by having a different name, sometimes the same name, so that you can reach out to a better startup and have a better discussion by just being a corporate, you know, for being slow or not responsive, or attracting only startups that are around your main core business. For example, Bertelsmann Venture wanted to invest only in telecom, but because it's called Bertelsmann Venture, media venture, they only attract media venture, and they say, you know, we don't want to do a media venture. We want to do, you know, telecom, because telecom is the next path for the next growth innovation area for media business, and therefore we want to attract telecom startups. And obviously, if you are called Bertelsmann, you attract only a media business. And it's like Nokia for telecom, AXA for insurance, et cetera, et cetera.
So I guess externalizing the model allow companies which are strong in specific industry to diversify portfolio and therefore mitigate long-term risk. I guess, you know, diversified portfolio is what we are all after. And so your model of corporate venturing is not only about de-risking, but also allowing new models to enter the market. Am I right?
Yes, you can enter the market for your core industry, but you can also reach out to new industry that can impact your industry, right? So if you're a retailer, so we discussed with a Spanish Portuguese corporate venture called Sonae IM from Sonae Group. It's a 400 million fund. They are investing in retail and infrastructure, but as a core business. But of course, fintech, for example, could disrupt retail. And of course, they want to be more exposed to financial services. And it's very hard to attract fintech startups when your name, you know, resonates with retail.
Fascinating. So as part of your business model, Min, you actually use four keywords: source, invest, develop, and exit. Can you tell us what that means and how you're actually using those four different paths to deliver value for your LPs?
Yes. So the framework I have is called SIDE, so source, invest, develop, exit. So source is basically your ability to source better than a corporate. So a corporate will source with people going to conference and so on. We use a stronger source mechanism by combining public data like Crunchbase with product data, so corporate assignments, to crawl some data and come out with a list of startups. So it's like AI sourcing, if you want, and so that we can combine the need for private information from corporates with public information that we can crawl from Crunchbase. So here we will do anyway much better than just a simple analyst in the corporate world. So that's step one. Step two, we invest like a VC. So there are no difference by just, you know, analyzing it better. And sometimes for corporates, we have an edge because we can see the possibility for the startup to generate value versus a corporate alignment, you know. So we have more VC view for corporates. And if we co-invest with VC, we can have a better corporate view for VC because we can tell the VCs, you know, if you align with this particular corporate, you will have a better return of investment because there's a lot of things that the corporate can do, like distribution, reinsurance sometimes, or just being a client, right? So that's why we do. We develop basically a portfolio management like any other VC, except that I do things more hands-on than VCs. I develop, build up, M&A. Sometimes I create funds or reinsurance captive for insurtech startups, things that a VC will not do because it will be stuck in investing in equity, while I can invest in startups and also create alternative funds, right? So I can invest in insurtech or can invest in a fintech, for example, that can do loans to enterprise. And I can, at the same time, create a debt fund that can deploy on the platforms. And usually a VC will not go to develop a debt fund. And obviously exit, because for corporation is basically an M&A action. But I use VC and I actually use VC techniques to actually exit at some point with or without the corporate, right? In that way. So I usually try to return the capital and therefore use you know, IPO, trade sale and so on, build up to exit, which is sometimes not the main priority for corporate when they invest in the startups.
Yeah. And I think it's important to also highlight why our models becomes really strong together. Because when you look at corporate venturing, and sometimes corporate venturing is getting a bad reputation because corporations which are entering the founding journey have to become closer to a VC mindset. And it doesn't happen overnight. And they also need to make sure that they recruit externally entrepreneurs, financier, industry expert to start building a portfolio which is going to yield return for their shareholders, which is often the HQ. But where our two model becomes really, really symbiotic is when you look at strategic return, I do a lot of the upfront work and we get a lot of the big themes and big problems from the insurance companies we're working with, which allows us to source amazing companies to solve for those problems, identify growth opportunities for partnership and investment. And then it's where you come in, where you can actually help our partners to do investment better, to use expertise, and then develop the right framework to hopefully exit financially in the future.
Yes, absolutely. My model doesn't cover the problem solving from insurance, for example. So I don't spend time to discuss about what is the next area of innovation, where do you invest, what kind of growth venture should you think about. So the framework of Alchemy, which is, you know, tech plus unfair advantage towards growth venture. I have the tech. But I don't necessarily know the unfair advantage, and I don't necessarily know when is the growth venture. So when the growth venture is clearly identified, then that's fine, because that's great, because I can actually apply my model, you know, source, invest, develop, exit in a most faster way.
So when you look at your tech, because you use a lot of tech as well, and you build your growth portfolio, Min, how do you select the themes? Because I'm sure your partners, for those you are investing for, share with you problem statements. So it would be great if you could actually share some of those with us and where you see disruption coming as you talk to your LPs.
So back in 2008, I worked in fintech after the crisis, and usually the insurance business have a cycle of 5 years behind banks. So naturally, back in 2012, I worked in the insurtech, but the insurtech, so the insurance people have a lot of assets to invest, and naturally, from InsurTech, I moved to asset management tech, which has ways to better collect or invest and so on. And within asset management, there are different asset classes. One of the biggest assets is real estate. And naturally, 5 years later, back in 2018, I look at PropTech, so technology that invest property management or real estate, so real estate or PropTech. And nowadays, InsurTech, PropTech, asset management tech, we discuss a lot about wealth tech or saving tech, whatever you want to name it, because people with COVID have some saving, they want to deploy, access new asset classes with impact. And so therefore, there's a new emerging theme around asset management and wealth tech combined. That could be named InvestTech, and also InvestTech, it's one of my themes. For example, in InvestTech, you have as a subcategory, decentralized finance. So basically how to use blockchain to cut the middleman in all kind of business, especially marketplaces.
So one thing you're actually highlighting is there's a lot of blurred lines. Even when we look at insurance tech or tech for insurers or insurance in the insurance market, what we find is there's always a bit of a blurred line between fintech, wealth tech, and insure tech. And then when we actually, because insurance touches everything, you know, a lot of our work will include, you know, looking for autonomous driving. It will include looking at smart building and smart homes. It will include looking at the future of energy and even looking at ESG and sustainability. So one key thing which is also important to highlight is when we look at success, we have to recognize that there is a lot of blurred lines among the sectors we are serving. And so therefore, it's not just straightforward insurance tech in my case, and in your case, prop tech or real tech or realistic tech, right?
Absolutely. And that's why when we talk to corporate, when they are looking into insure tech and they want to be exposed to other tech, it's good that an external model can help you to access those industries where you have or you have not an expertise. So today, with the insurance business, I have three I, you know, InsurTech, InvestTech, and ImpactTech, which basically cover, you know, the key theme that the, you know, the my next key themes for search and investments.
So you mentioned impact tech, for instance, which gets us into, you know, sustainability, potentially. Yes. So when you look at the world of sustainability, how do you look at it today, Min?
I looked at, ESG and so on, but very quickly I came to the conclusion that there was no, despite different E, different S, different G, there's no one common denominator for impact measurement. So in impact tech, I focus more on marketplaces, decentralized finance, as you know, but also I focus a lot of work on where to invest to have the best impact tools or impact platform to do measurement. When you do in private equity, how to measure, when you do in real estate and so on, how to measure. So impact scoring, measurement, index, fund and so on, it's quite a topic of interest. So that's more or less my next investment thesis, how to invest in tools or platform that can measure the impact of a company, public or private. And, you know, there's a company called Clarity outside AI that I looked at a few months back, and they got a big investment from BlackRock. So that's that shows that I'm not the only one looking at that.
Yeah, certainly. So my next question is, based on your 30 years of experience, Minh, you know, how do you identify sustainable growth ventures? So what are the criteria you look for?
So when I look at the growth venture, like in EVC, I will look at the framework of Bell-Manson, which is whether the market is big and deep and growing, whether the product fits the market from MVP to a full beta version. What's the business model, the business plan, are the unit economics, and what are the teams? So that's very much the four dimension that a VC will look at it. Because I do VC as a service for corporates or CVC as a service, I look also at the fifth element called the leverage with the corporate, which could be interesting to accelerate the startup or the valuation of startups. In the insurance business, for example, there are three levels of corporate leverage. The first is no-brainer is that the insurance is the customer of the startup, right? So corporate client. The second one is the partnership for distribution. The insurance partner with the startups to distribute the technology going forward in the services and new insurance. And the third one is the startup wants to introduce a new insurance product and they need reinsurance capacity. And therefore, this is a very particular thing that I do so that I can work on that particular point as well when startup use the business model of a broker or and become an MGA. So that's something that we've seen more and more, the birth of MGAs from the startup world.
Fascinating. So what are your last words of wisdom, Minh, for our listeners?
I think from recent conversation, I think I keep it summarized in one sentence. It's not because it's hard that you don't do it. It's because you don't do that it's become hard. And therefore, for corporate to find it hard to do CVC, it becomes harder if they don't actually, they're stuck in the internal model. And today there's, you can do on the shelf CVC as a service, because you can actually start within a few weeks, use CVC, with no internal constraint.
Thank you, Minh. Thank you for your...
Thank you, Sabine.
...words of wisdom. Until next time. If you like this podcast, subscribe now, share with your friends, and if you enjoyed it, please give it a 5-star review. Also, if you want to cover any specific subject with me, contact me on Instagram under Sabine VdL Officials or LinkedIn under Sabine van der Linden. Thank you.